Aesthetic analyses of ancient Egyptian bronzes are plentiful, emphasizing their beauty, elegance, and refinery. Many of these discussions, however, overlook in-depth analyses of the chain of pouvoir which can be used to understand agency in ancient technology, insofar as technology itself was an embodied social act. Significantly, the ancient Egyptians never recorded any description of any craft production, and while many scholars have suggested the use of lost wax casting in Egyptian metalworking, we argue that this conclusion not only ignores significant technical obstacles, but overlooks the enigmatic complexities of craft production scenes in Egyptian art. We argue that these scenes are heavily imbued with religious connotations and therefore cannot be read literally, as some scholars have done in the past. Studies of ancient Egyptian material culture broadly have also focused on the visible, without any serious regard for the complete sensory experience that the object would have originally elicited. The Egyptians perceived the divine as a full-body experience, with an emphasis on the senses, especially in cultic contexts. What we hear, in other words, we hear because sound mingles in the air, which is itself divine, and so hearing and producing sound takes on a sacramental aspect, a vitalizing act for both the human and the divine. Sound is a moment where the two realities are no longer separate. In this paper, we'll investigate the metallic properties of copper alloy ancient Egyptian loop sistra that first appear during the first half of the 12th dynasty and reappear in the 18th dynasty when they become decorated with the double face of the solar goddess Hathor. In their most dominant form, these sistra are composed of a two-part cast handle. A thin loop can either be riveted or brazed to a U-shaped capital and pierced on either side for cross pins, which support thin metal discs, the instrument in its entirety measuring an average of 12 inches in height. Hymns to Hathor regularly imply the shaking of sistra, which is to be accompanied by dance, highlighting the sacramental aspect of producing and hearing sound, in full agreement with the ancient Egyptian belief that the divine is perceived through the senses as a full-body experience. Later Middle Kingdom texts reveal the material's solar connotations. The stellar of Inspector Keddie from Wadi Magara describes, for example, shining copper, bia pesej. Here, the adjective is written using the sun with sunbeams determinative, implying that the material shares its radiant quality with the sun. Middle Kingdom Kaufman text 17, which reappears in the New Kingdom Book of the Dead, similarly describes the metal. Quote, O Ra, who is in his egg, who shines in his disk, who radiates in his horizon, who swims in his copper. The verb nebi, to swim, is almost certainly a sound play as a homonym of the verb nebi, to smelt, the gods shining, enigmatically evoking the act of smelting copper.
The fine details of the handles suggest production via the lost wax casting process, practiced in Egypt by at least the 2nd dynasty, 3000 BCE. The earliest Egyptian evidence for beekeeping dates to the 1st dynasty, 5000 years ago. The process has long been recognized in the ancient world, although archaeological evidence of ancient wax is somewhat rare, leading to much speculation over the composition of the wax used in the process. Nevertheless, scholars generally agree that the primary constituent was filtered beeswax, which has the property of becoming more pliable as it is warmed, its melting point between 140 degrees and 151 degrees Fahrenheit. It rapidly becomes rigid as it cools. We tried molding a sistrum handle with three different wax compositions, highly filtered beeswax and turpentine, unfiltered beeswax with turpentine, and pure unfiltered beeswax. Only the pure unfiltered beeswax handle was successful. This wax carved smoothly and did not leave behind carving debris as the other waxes did. This handle was also the most durable of the three once it completely cooled.
Sand casting is rarely mentioned in ancient Egyptian metalworking scholarly discussions, but the technology was certainly available. The earliest sand casting evidence to date comes from an early 2nd millennium BC workshop at the site of Tel el-Daba in Baghdad, not Egypt. But the crucibles found at the site are identical to those depicted in the Old Kingdom tomb of Merruka at Saqqara, suggesting possible Egyptian influence and perhaps a longer sandcasting tradition than the archaeological record can account for due to post-use disintegration. We made the investment mold with a low-fire terracotta clay to simulate the natural Egyptian earthenware. Since the clay was somewhat stiff and unlikely to capture all the fine details of the wax pattern, we mixed some clay with water to coat the handle before encasing it fully in clay.
We use our beeswax handle as a pattern for both the cope and drag sand mold and a lost wax mold. The bottom of the mold was left open and shaped into a funnel. The mold is inverted and fired, drying the clay and allowing the wax to run out. Any water left in the clay when molten bronze is poured in will expand rapidly as gas and cause the mold to shatter. Our furnace was an antique propane-powered plumber's lead melting furnace which we outfitted with refractory kaol wool, creating an enclosed space, the propane simulating the airflow and heat that in ancient times would have been generated by blowpipes, bellows, or natural winds. We were able to achieve temperatures in excess of 2,000 degrees, more than enough to melt copper, whose melting point is around 1,981 degrees. Recent scholarship has suggested that one man with a blowpipe was also capable of achieving temperatures in excess of 2,000 degrees using a fuel bed of charcoal. Charcoal, however, is an expendable resource whose availability is not always certain in arid regions. Fuel scarcity may in part be responsible for the continual depictions of multiple blowpipes and bellows in Egyptian art. These methods also result in differential heating, evidence of which is found in the ubiquity of broken crucibles at ancient smelting sites. We selected a graphite crucible for our experiments because of the high carbon content, 75 to 80%, simulating the charcoal lining found in many ancient crucibles. The carbon is not only an excellent heat conductor, but also somewhat resistant to thermal shock.
The intensity of the heat and glow radiating from the crucible as the material approaches its melting point makes it nearly impossible to observe directly, the molten metal akin to the fiery sun in its red-hot vessels, just as the coffin text spell cited earlier suggests. The textual reference is strengthened by visual evidence, notably from New Kingdom tomb of Purim Ra in Thebes, which depicts a smelting scene with the crucible identical to the hieroglyph for the horizon, Akit, where the molten metal is shown in place of the sun. Recall that the coffin text spell does not explicitly claim that Ra is the sun, although he does radiate. More likely, the disk, and in this case the crucible, is symbolic of the god, who is not visible, but whose presence is sensed as fiery brilliance and heat.
The sand cast handle was a partial success. The mold separated slightly during pouring, which left a seam around the perimeter of the handle, and smoothed the facial details on one side. The other side held its details very well. The lost wax cast handle was our most successful out of the set. The clay broke during the casting, and some bronze escaped and solidified outside the mold. Luckily, all of the facial details from the wax pattern were captured. We attempted two manufacturing methods to prepare the loop. Mold 5 and open mold sand mold, using a steel flat bar to make the impression in the sand. We used a beeswax pattern for a cope and drag mold, since it was easy to shape and punch holes through. We used small wooden pins inside the mold to retain the pinholes during casting. We added small expansion runners into the cope to allow gases to escape, since copper tends to retain these gases in closed molds, resulting in a porous casting. We intended loop 1 to be a solid cast bar, which would be hammered to thin and shape it before bending a radius. We poured the bronze along the length of the mold, starting at one end. There was some overflow and surface oxidation, but the result was acceptable. Loop 2 was successfully cast in the cope and drag sand mold with minimal overflow. The surface retained some of the irregularities of the wax pattern, and the holes were preserved by the wooden inserts. In the future, we'll attempt an open sand mold using a pre-shaped loop form instead of a flat bar to reduce post-work time and the high stresses imparted into the bar from cold working and bending. The bronze discs were made using steel discs as patterns. After an unsuccessful cope and drag casting, we removed the drag and used it alone to cast as an open mold. This yielded only a few usable discs, so we did one additional casting into a 50 caliber musket ball mold, which we later flattened. Since the pins require extreme ductility for bending, we used pure copper. We were able to successfully cast 6 pins, but the copper discs were difficult to pour accurately, almost certainly due to the size and weight of our crucible. The discs and pins were totally unusable and so were not used in the final project. This method is still plausible, however, but needs refining for future work.
One of the earliest known references to annealing in ancient Egypt comes from the 5th dynasty mastaba tomb of Wepemnofra at Giza. 3 sequential scenes and accompanying inscription, to be read from right to left, should by now appear familiar. The individuals on the far right are shown kneeling and forcing air into a pile of charcoal fuel. The text above these workers reads, "Hurry, quickly put it at its base." Molten metal has a very short pouring window before it solidifies, and so the inscription is almost certainly in order to direct the blowpipe toward the base of the crucible to maintain the fire. Left of the kneeling smelters, a man pours a horn-shaped crucible. typical of the Old Kingdom style and consistent with those shown earlier in the tomb of Mararuka. The metal worker holds the crucible between two stones pouring from the base of the crucible. The two men seated to the far left are shown about to strike a rectangular object resting on the surface of either stone or wood with oval stones like those in the pouring scene. The caption behind the worker on the right tells us that the rectangular object is shining copper. And the worker on the right says, "Heat this, it is dried up," it being copper. The worker on the left comments, "There is no cracking if it's heated excellently." In light of our experiments, we understand that the worker is referencing the process of annealing, and certainly the act that the two are engaged in is drawing out the solidified copper, which, as we've just seen, does indeed shine after quenching, meaning that these workers are, at the very minimum, reheating the copper for the second time, and likely repeated the process several more times.
We attempted both hot and cold forging on the open mold cast bronze bar, achieving a slight reduction in thickness, but also developing significant stress fractures, since bronze is a work-hardening material. Even with annealing, the composition of this bar, 80% copper and 20% tin, did not lend itself nicely to forging. Instead, it was used as a test piece for bending. It was annealed and then bent roughly 10 to 15 degrees at a time, annealing between bends, until about a 180-degree radius was achieved. We decided against using this bar in the finished product since it was cast without pinholes and it suffered a large amount of cracking during working and bending. We filed the edges of the pure copper loop and removed the sprues. We found that the copper was highly porous. Some large pores were visible on the surface and many more riddled the interior. This suggested our mold was not sufficiently vented. Based on the previous results, we annealed this loop prior to hammering, working from the center towards the ends to thin and lengthen it, which took a number of rounds to complete. The bar was still rather thick. We used a steel punch to open and widen the holes, and annealed the bar again with a focus mainly around the center where bending would occur. Like the first loop, bends were no greater than 10 degrees and were alternated with rounds of annealing. Unfortunately, the bar broke during bending, but we took advantage of this moment to use brazing to simulate a plausible Egyptian repair method suggested by Garland, in which molten metal is poured over and into an area of a break and allowed to harden, perhaps surrounded by clay to avoid overflow. It's difficult to imagine that the Egyptians would have simply abandoned a salvageable piece after so much work was already put into it. We were able to braze the two halves together, completing the repair.
The cast discs were annealed and hammered flat, alternating work and annealing, as with the bars. The bronze musket ball halves yielded only 6 workable samples, but only one was successfully flattened to nearly 1 inch diameter. The holes were made using a steel punch. The musket ball disc broke in half after the hole was punched through it. Ultimately, none of these musket balls were usable. However, they represent another plausible method of making the discs.
The copper loop was braced with the clamp and then brazed to the capital. It was quenched in water to cool. We used files, wire brushes, and sandpaper to remove built-up oxides and residue from the brazing flux. Since the pure copper pins were not successfully worked from the cast state, copper wire was salvaged and used in their place. The ends were flattened to form the snake heads. Two of the cast discs were installed in the sistrum, with others cut from copper sheet, completing the sistrum. Verifiable molds for sistra production are lacking in the archaeological record, so we suspect that the primary method of production is lost wax, with the loop and discs being cast in open molds to near-net shapes, as this is most economical. But our experiment opens the door to suggest additional means of production are possible.
As we've hopefully demonstrated by now, it would be an injustice to describe metalworking in ancient Egypt as a purely technical operation. The elusive tomb imagery, sparse inscriptions, and uncertainty surrounding certain metallurgical terminology all point to a tradition steeped in secrecy, knowledge of which was highly restricted.